Marita. How are you today?
Thank you.
Come along, please. Open the bags, please. And the handbag there. Thank you. Morning, sir.
Good morning. This is empty. When I come out, it will be full. It will have
it will. Well,
a 50-year-old Roman head in.
Well, you're a lucky man, sir.
One is coins and medals, and the other one is the Department of Medieval and Later Antiquities.
French novels of the 18th century.
In the classical Egyptian.
I find the Elgin marble.
Get a 73 bus from there. We'll bring you to Tottenham Court Road.
Excuse me, can you tell me where the things from Sutton Hoo are?
It sounds like they reused the bathroom, doesn't it?
Exactly.
First colonnade and then upward. You'll see the great frieze of the bus.
Mounting porcelains. How are we to find which one?
These are the underground galleries of a mine shaft cut through chalk, about 45 feet below the surface of the ground. The people who cut these galleries were searching for flint. Flint mining started here about 4,000 years ago, that is, before 2000 BC. At that time in Britain, flint was still the most valuable raw material for making tools and weapons. Up on the surface, the only traces of underground mining are these grassy hollows, which have given the site its name. This is Grime's Graves in Norfolk, but there are no graves here. The mines were named after the god Grim or Woden in Anglo-Saxon times. Grime's Graves really means Grim's Diggings. It's a big site. Few of the other prehistoric flint mines in Europe are as large. The grassed-over craters, which are the tops of filled-in mine shafts, cover about 15 acres. From the shallowest to the deepest, there are about 500 of these pits. Each of the 500 shafts is a considerable structure in itself, again, possibly the largest of any European mine. But the mining site as a whole is far bigger, perhaps three or four times as large. Here there are traces of surface workshops where mined flint was broken up for use as tools. There was a great deal of open cast mining here as well, covering the whole of one side of the hill. There is also a possibility of studying the unusual Bronze Age inhabitants of Grime's Graves after the mines have closed down. So, for the first modern survey of prehistoric flint mining, which is what the British Museum decided to undertake, it's clear that Grime's Graves offers great advantages. The time is about 2000 BC. No towns, hardly even any villages, are known in Britain at this time, or for several hundred years afterwards. There are only isolated farm buildings, small groups of houses, and a few large monuments, like Durrington Walls in Wiltshire. The Durrington Walls type of monument, the immediate precursors of Stonehenge, are surrounded by enormous deep chalk-cut ditches, dug in the same way as Grime's Graves. Compared with the size of a normal permanent farm settlement, the 95 acres or so of Grime's Graves seem at first to suggest mining and manufacturing of flint on almost a modern industrial scale. Indeed, there are those who have spoken of Grime's Graves in terms of a first industrial revolution. The earliest European evidence of a separate group of workers, the miners, specializing in the production of a single commodity, flint. But was the flint mining field exploited intensively by a large number of full-time miners over a short period? Or were the mines open consecutively over several hundred years, in a rather more haphazard and amateur way. To explore issues of this sort, we must try to reconstruct the techniques and procedures of the prehistoric miners at Grime's graves. How was the mining actually done? How long did it take to dig the shaft and galleries? How much flint came out of a mine and what happened to it then? How many people were involved? It's the underground structures that are at once the most unusual and most spectacular part of the mining at Grime's graves. These conceal quite unusual forms of evidence because they have remained unvisited and unspoiled ever since the miners left them 4,000 years ago. Their real beauty for the archaeologist is that it seems they could provide measured quantitative answers to questions about mining techniques and output. One of the mine shafts is still known as Greenwell's Pit, after Canon William Greenwell, the man who first excavated it more than 100 years ago.
Here I'm standing on the edge of the shaft which we have just cleared and whose sides we're examining. At the base of the shaft are the galleries which contain the flint level which the Neolithic miners wanted to collect. We've worked out that if you consider that one man requires a square yard to do his excavation, we've got room for about 20 people on the surface to start off digging this shaft. Here at the top, you have got to cut it back because it's sand, but just below my feet, it becomes solid chalk, and you can make a vertical shaft and a slightly narrower one. Only 10 men could be employed about halfway down, but the other 10 men would be required to carry material up to the surface. The Neolithic miners carried the chalk and sand out of the shaft by means of baskets, up the ladders, and also by ropes. Their ladders were not as long as the ones we've got here. They probably had two ladders, one halfway up, and then another one coming up to the surface, as well as using ropes for pulling material up. Almost immediately, one comes across two or three lines of flints in the chalk, horizontal lines of flints. Now, at this point is where they cut a shelf to put the stage for receiving the first ladder from the base of the shaft. And this is where loads were transferred, probably from one Neolithic flint miner to another, to carry on up into the open air at the top of the shaft. As we go down the shaft, we see the layers of inferior flint, which the miners cut through. No doubt they used them when they got good enough blocks. And a little lower, at the level traditionally known as top stone, is the last line of these flint nodules, a perfectly horizontal line of flint nodules that runs right round the shaft. And they didn't ignore these. I no doubt they collected the ones which looked best, but they were after the floor stone, which is in fact as far as the mining of the shaft goes. It's called floor stone. This is this thick level of tabular flint which runs round the base of the shaft itself. This maze of corridors is quite misleading. In fact, if you search in the flint mines, you find every now and then a good, long, straight gallery like this one, which, in fact, is just what the miners were cutting. The typical gallery was about 2 foot, 6 to 3 foot in height, and about the same in width, enough for a man to get through with the flint, and not too wide, so that the ceiling doesn't come down on top of him. This is where the actual mining took place. We have cleared it of debris, and we've installed these solid steel girders, which you see here, for safety reasons. But otherwise, it's very much as the Neolithic miners left it. And it shows quite clearly the way in which mining took place. First of all, if you look into this room here, into this gallery, this part of the gallery, you'll see that the flint, this black layer, running round the floor, and you can see that it's a good thick band, almost flat, but there are bigger blocks in it. And of course, the flint that you can see is the flint the miners have left behind. They advanced at the level of the flint, picking it up in front of them. So the whole of this floor was originally covered with flint. You can see there are minor irregularities, and there are also deep hollows. This must be contained very heavy and thick lumps of flint, particularly valuable for manufacturing purposes. These were carried to the surface and made into flint tools. These prehistoric galleries are seldom more than 20 or 30 yards in length. If you crawl down one of them, you get to the point where mining has ceased. The reason why, nearly always, is that the miners have got to a place where they cut a hole through the wall in front of them and find that mining has already taken place on the other side. This type of hole we refer to as a window. Here is a window, a fairly small one. As you can see, nobody has ever been through this. It's far too small for a human being to do so, but it's quite big enough to see what was on the other side. In this case, a gallery untouched since the mining has taken place. It's full of debris. There are three or four of the characteristic mining tools, the red deer antler picks, lying on the floor, and one particularly interesting one, a unique find in my opinion, as an antler pick holding up a flake of chalk. Presumably this was a danger point while they were doing the mining.
Apart from antler picks, there are very few objects left behind underground at Grime's graves. The evidence lies rather in the appearance of the mines themselves, particularly their size and scale in relation to human beings. It's these dimensions we have to investigate rather than the individual artifacts. This is how the underground galleries look when the archaeologist arrives, half filled with chalk. The miners have taken away the flint, but the chalk has only been shunted about to provide a passageway or packed back into galleries when the mining had moved on. If the galleries were quite clear, we would know less about the mining techniques. The position and slope of the chalk heaps can be used to work out the direction of mining, and the way the chalk heaps overlie one another shows which gallery was mined first. But it needs experience to interpret this sort of evidence, some practical understanding of real mining. There's only one organization with this kind of flint mining expertise, a group of miners, geologists, and engineers in Holland, who have come together to apply their familiarity with modern mining to the study of prehistoric mining techniques. Their flint mines are here at Reichhold, in the southern tip of the Netherlands. Instead of being preserved in a patch of open country like Grime's graves, most of the mines at Reichhold are concealed under woodland.
The basic situation at Reichhold is really very simple. A chalk hill has been formed by the river cutting down through a thick layer of chalk with lines of flint in it. The chalk hill's got a flat top and sloping sides, and the flint mines are pierced from the top, and all the way down the sides there are small quarries where lines of flint come up to the surface. The quarries are not always visible, there are small holes from place to place, but the vegetation gives the game away because you can see ivy where the chalk has been brought up to the surface. The flat top and the sides of the hill are covered with sand. The hill beneath is of chalk. The ivy grows on chalk and it doesn't grow on sand. And ferns grow on the sand and not on the chalk. So you can see the heaps of sand by the ferns, and you can see the holes, the position where the ground has been disturbed and the chalk has come to the surface by the ivy. Not only the ivy on the ground, but the ivy up the trees. So by merely looking at groups of trees here and seeing whether they're covered with ivy or not, you can see where the flint has been exploited.
Although they were tunneling for flint through chalk, the prehistoric miners of Holland were working beneath this slope about 1,000 years earlier than the miners in Norfolk. But comparing their methods and results, just because they are so different, may help to pick out what is significant in the layout of Grime's graves. Jeff Felder is a mining engineer and was for many years a face worker in the Dutch coal mines. Now he applies his experience to the analysis of prehistoric mining techniques. The Dutch team have driven a big modern corridor into the side of the hill to find the flint mines. The horizontal corridor slices right through the galleries and shafts, like a new hole in a Gruyere cheese. It's about 300 meters long, and the sliced through galleries lead off on either side so that you can inspect them.
Yeah, a vault, yes. And it is called stay on. 80
meters. If we come into one of these galleries, does that mean that we're going to go uphill?
Yes, we go here uphill, unless we go into it.
But straight away, you can see the differences between the Norfolk and the Dutch mines. The Reichhold galleries are narrower and shorter, and the miners use different methods because of local conditions, or because of different mining traditions.
We move in the next gallery.
Well, yes, you can get round there. I could never. Yes. This is a typical length of Reichhold gallery.
There's only room enough for one man, and not more. It's not possible to work in such a gallery with two men. All the galleries are of this size and not larger. The flint isn't bent, but isolated nodules. And that is only left small pieces of flint into the wall. The bigger lumps were taken away by the prehistoric miners. And he left only that small pieces in the wall.
It's very solid chalk.
It looks very solid, but it is a soft chalk. It is possible to crack this chalk with your hands. To crack it in small pieces. And so it is a very soft chalk.
Too soft for antler picks, is that right?
Yes, that is right. It is not possible to cut it with an antler pick.
So it's done in a different way from Grime's graves?
In completely different way. It is better to use a knife here in that soft chalk. And so they did use flint picks to cut the chalk away.
How can we use the Reichholt flint mine and these galleries to tell us about flint mining in England at Grime's graves, where the situation seems very different?
Because the size of the galleries indicates one man work in the galleries. We have the basic measurements about that. And so we can, these basic measurements, compare with the measurements we found at Grime's caves, what are larger mines as this here. And so we can calculate the number of men what was working at Grime's caves, based on that on this measurements of Reichholt. Oh, there's a narrow gallery here.
A very tight squeeze.
Yes.
So let me show you one of the flint eggs we found here. And on the ceiling, we can see here the marks they made in the chalk. There's a long mark. We found this in a big number, about 15,000 of them, 20, 25 together.
The antler picks were found in heaps, and these things are found in heaps. These are the principal tools. Over here, we can see one of the shafts that are the main access to these galleries. Beautifully circular, even when it's in sand. So how did they get down these shafts without bringing down all the sand? And how did they haul up all their flints?
So we are in the shafts, and I can show you the small size, about 3 foot. And you were asking me, the brown earth above us, how they did build the shaft in that particularly thing. Now, we don't really know it, but we believe that they use baskets to put in it. In the chalk, it wasn't necessary. And to get into the shaft, it was easy because they used ropes. And the same ropes he used for to get up the flint. And also for to get out of the shaft, there were a rope climbing to the surface.
So they lined the shaft at the top where the sand was with basket.
Yes.
And then they lowered themselves down on ropes or rope ladders.
No, not on rope ladders, on the rope itself. And it is very easy because it is a small shaft, and your elbows and your legs, you can push into the wall of the shaft, and so you can get easy down and easy up.
The small galleries at Reichholt show how few people were employed. So we seem to be looking at a lot of little mines, none of which could usefully have contained more than two men, one behind another. One to excavate and one to transport the flint up the shaft. Compare the two mining operations in Holland and Norfolk, and the differences seem to imply different ways of working and a larger workforce at Grime's graves. We've already concluded that the circumference of the Norfolk shafts at the top presupposes 20 men digging together. Then, halfway down at the staging point, the shaft shrinks, and the number of diggers possibly goes down to 10, with the remaining 10 perhaps employed in pulling up the chalk waste in baskets. But what happens at the bottom of the shaft? Here in Greenwell's pit, there are 7 galleries leading away from the base of the shaft. Only 4 of these galleries belong to our mine. The other entrances are either windows, like the one we saw earlier, or galleries that have broken through from other nearby mine shafts. We've measured the 4 true Greenwell galleries that belong to our shaft, and they are all different lengths. So the question here is, do the different lengths of the galleries tell us anything about the number of miners employed, and can we use that to work out the sequence of mining? The thing to remember is that you need one man to wield a pick and another man to remove the chalk.
Yes, we can explain that in the best way in stages. We are on the base at the shaft, and 4 quarrying men make 4 galleries. In the first stage is going on with these 4 galleries to a length of 4 meters. And then they had to stop one of the galleries because they needed a helpman each 2 meters in a gallery. So they were going on at the second stage to 6 meters with 3 galleries. And after that, we got the third stage. 2 galleries are going to 8 meters in length. And after that, we get the fourth stage. 1 gallery is going on to 11 meters.
More miners were needed in every gallery at each stage. But in this pit, the labor supply was insufficient and progressively limited both the number of galleries exploited and their lengths.
But why didn't they go on making longer and longer galleries all over the hill instead of digging these great big shafts?
That is easy to understand if we know that you have to crawl into the galleries in a length from, let us say, in that way, 11 meters. And crawl into that narrow gallery isn't easy to do. So it is better to make a new shaft instead to make the galleries longer as the depth of the shaft.
Could they come back and go on with the galleries they had stopped before?
No, because after they reached 11 meters in the longest gallery, the remaining galleries were nearly complete filled with waste chalk.
So now we have a picture of a complete flint mine, a shaft and galleries, and some idea about how many miners were working underground. And the picture is of an efficiently organized pre-planned system. The prehistoric miners of Grime's graves didn't simply attack the flint at random. They realized that the deeper you tunnel into the chalk, the more waste you create, and the more men have to be diverted from flint production into waste dispersal. After a certain point, the effort involved in reaching the flint face and getting rid of the chalk spoil is counterproductive, and it's more efficient to start a whole new shaft. But how did they actually do the mining? On the walls of this mine, there are still the marks left by the tools the prehistoric flint miners were using. Here are marks in the chalk made by a polished stone axe. You can recognize the shape of the axe blade. There are also marks left by what must have been the main mining tool, a miner's pick made from the antler of a red deer. Lots of broken antler picks are found among the waste chalk. Usually they're found in ones or twos where they have been thrown away.
This, however, is a group of antlers, and it's quite clear that when they broke their antlers, they came for a new one, a new pick. they put two or three broken ones down, took some new picks away, and left buried underneath one or two antler picks which were never used. There's a certain amount of wastage here, just as there is in modern industry. About 150 red deer antlers have been found in the galleries of this shaft, and we've always thought that they were used for mining tools, but we've never really worked out how they were used. If you look at a modern red deer antler, I've got one here, which has been prepared, you'll see that it resembles a miner's pick. It's a sort of L-shaped thing, and it's got a point here. This point is very near the end of the beam, the place where it was attached to the head of the red deer. The first archaeologists to examine these galleries thought that they were used to lever lumps out by sticking the point in and using it as a lever. But this doesn't appear to be so.
To have any effect on a solid chalk wall with an antler pick, the prehistoric miners were experienced enough to have discovered that the most obvious way isn't the most efficient way.
Let me explain how the miner did her work at the front of a gallery. First of all, I show the chalk, what is jointed into lumps. And here we can see the flint he wants. First of all, he made a groove above the flint. I try to do the same. If you make a groove above the flint, what is easy, because on top of the flint, there's a soft layer, breaks off the tension of the lumps. Sometimes it is easier to use the backside of the antler as a hammer to knock on the lumps and to get off. After moving away all these blocks, it is possible to take away the flint. But before, I have to move some lumps. As normal, the flint at Grime's caves is shattered. What the miner had to do now is enlarge the gallery to get room enough to go on to the next flint. And therefore he used this axe, and I show it.
We have reproduced experimentally the technique to show that the mining methods are practical and to work out the speed of mining. By experiments like this, you can discover that a miner could cover about 1 square meter a day in the galleries. We've already decided how many miners were at work underground, but how do we find out how much flint they took up?
It is nice here at Grime's Caves because we have here moles in the floor of the galleries.
Oh, these hollows?
These hollows we can see in the floor. It is easy to measure the area of that hollow.
What proportion do you think the miners got out? About 70% or something?
Yeah, and I think if we get the complete area, there is about 75%. Of all the flint, the miners have taken out.
How does that compare with modern mining practice?
In modern mining types, we get only 60% out, same system.
So how much flint do you think the miners got from this
little niche, this little gallery that we're in now?
I don't exactly know how many the amount is from this niche.
Yes.
Because it is in the way, I said, you need many hollows for
calculation.
Yes. But I can say every square meter, mm-hmm. we got 325 kilos of of flint.
325 kilos.
Yes, and that means for that area, what is about 10 square meters, about 3,250 kilos of flint from that small area.
From this small area.
Yes.
That is a calculation based on what we've just measured in all the galleries at Greenwell's.
Yes. Yes, that is right.
So that gives us a good mean calculation of, works out to how many tons?
At Greenwell's bit, we got about 50,000 of kilos.
50,000 kilos.
50 tons.
50
of,
tons.
Of flint.
From Greenwell's bit.
Only from Greenwell's bit.
So that's the total from one mine obtained by careful measurement of the shaft and galleries. We already have two other experimental results, the amount each miner could dig in a day, and the number of miners involved in each pit. Putting all three factors together, you can now calculate the time taken to dig out one complete mine. And that, in turn, may help to solve the problem we started with. Did the Neolithic miners of Grime's Graves operate as full-time specialists? Or were they basically farmers doing a little flint mining in their spare time?
It's after we know that a miner could do about a half of a cubic meter in a day in the shaft and one square meter a day in a gallery, and after calculations about the number of persons working and quarrying in this particular shaft, we know the shaft took about 100 days to dig them on the bottom, and the galleries about 40 days.
So that's 140 days, and they dig this enormous shaft, and they only get the flint when they get to the bottom of the shaft.
Yes, that is right.
Is it worthwhile in terms of the amount of flint that they get to pay them to dig this big shaft and the galleries?
Yes, I'm sure, because the amount of flint they could get out, extracted here from these galleries, not only from the shaft, but from the galleries, that is enormous. About 50 tons they get out here. And in the days of working, only the working days, they get out each day 1.5 ton of flint.
After they've got to the bottom?
After they get to the bottom. So it is worth to take a big shaft in 100 of days for to get out that amount of flint. In a short time, about 40 days, and each day, about in the best days, 1.5 ton.
So at the moment, it seems that each of the 500 mines must have taken less than 6 months to complete, a single 6 month stretch without a break. In fact, there's some evidence of a quite different and unusual kind which bears out that estimate. Each winter, during the 3 years we've excavated, about 30 wild animals fell down the open shaft and died. But when we dug out the prehistoric galleries, we did not find a single dead animal. This seems clear evidence that after the 6 month period, the mine was abandoned and the shaft filled in with chalk from the next pit, which was being dug nearby. In assessing the importance of Grime's Graves, we need to know how long it took for all 500 mines to be exhausted and when it all started. The antler picks date the mining period to around 2000 BC. But there are some interesting problems involved in estimating how long the mines were operating. All living matter absorbs radioactive carbon according to how much is present in the atmosphere from year to year. And the deer antler picks which the miners left behind are living matter. If you apply the familiar radiocarbon dating technique, to a range of antlers from the galleries of several different mines, the result seems to suggest that the mines, as a whole, were being worked over a period of about 300 years. It's when you try and discover a more exact dating within that period that something seems to go wrong. If you look at antlers from the same gallery of the same pit, Greenwells, the radiocarbon result is quite surprising. The archaeological evidence has already told us that mining could only have taken a few months in any single pit. As the miners left hundreds of worn-out antler picks in every pit each year, those antlers should all give us very much the same date. But they don't. We get a whole range of dates still spanning 300 years.
We believe that the differences we see between the dates are real, and we think these are due to the short-term variations that there may have been in carbon-14 from year to year, which are preserved in the antlers, which are themselves the record of 1 year's growth. As you know, antlers are grown and shed each year, and they preserve a record of the carbon-14 activity of the atmosphere at the time of growth, and this may vary slightly from year to year, which gives us an apparent difference between the age of our samples.
Our antler dating experiments imply that short-lived material, sealed up quickly underground, has produced previously unknown evidence of considerable annual variations of radiocarbon concentration in the atmosphere. So now we are cross-checking the radiocarbon evidence at Grime's graves by measuring the age of a series of single tree rings, each of which records 1 year's growth. Using a piece of timber of about the same age as Grime's graves, we're dating a consecutive series of 50 annual growth rings to see if they show the same major variations in age as we found in the deer antlers.
If we see the same sorts of variations in these tree rings, then I think that we will be convinced that we are seeing a real atmospheric effect and not something peculiar to the antlers themselves. And this, of course, has important bearing on carbon-14 dating, on the selection of sample materials and on the suitability of sample materials for dating. All short-lived material will tend to give these sorts of variations, so that we would have to be careful about the use of grass or samples that had lived for a very short time, linen and so forth, which represent 1 year's growth. Interestingly, samples which had previously been especially selected because of their suitability for radiocarbon, before it was realized that these short-term variations may take place. But it is certainly true that this is a research aspect of the work, and there's a great deal to be done before the full picture is understood. I think this has been a bonus as far as this work is concerned, that we set out to do archaeological dating, and we have got some extra information about radiocarbon dating.
The work is still continuing. If the tree rings also show considerable variations, then it's possible that we're dealing with genuine fluctuations in the amount of radioactive carbon in the atmosphere at the time when the Neolithic miners were digging flint out of Greenwell's pit. We've already calculated that about 1.5 tons of mined flint per day came out of Greenwell's pit. But how much of that could be turned into tools and weapons? Using the same tools as a Neolithic flint napper, you can carry out a time and motion experiment on the making, for example, of a flint axe head. Mark Newcomer specializes in reproducing the methods of manufacture and use of early tools and weapons. The Grimes Graves flint has an unusually fine texture, which makes it an ideal material for flaking. The axe produced is usually much less than half the size of the original lump, and large numbers of flakes are left behind each time an axe is made. From the amount of waste flint left over, you can estimate the number of successful axes made. So far, we've counted 750,000 flakes from one area like this, and we're still counting, so we don't know the answer yet. But based on the debris of a similar Knapping floor, one archaeologist has calculated that 20,000 axe heads were made there in one year. Quantities of that order are far greater than could have been used up every year by a small group of miners or by the farmers in the district. So what happened to all those flint tools once they've been carried off the site? Although flint is mostly silica and water, it also contains a number of trace elements like sodium and potassium, present in very tiny quantities. We've taken 7 of the trace elements as our yardstick. Each of the prehistoric British mines we know of produced flint with different proportions of those 7 elements. You can therefore analyze the composition of flint tools made of mined flint found throughout Britain and decide which particular mine the flint originally came from. The computer assigns this axe, for example, to Grime's graves. Of the nearly 10,000 flint axes in different museums around the country, we've so far analysed only 500. That's not nearly enough to postulate any complicated patterns of movement for flint tools. But already it's clear that axes from Grime's graves travelled over quite a wide area of southern Britain. Looking back over the Grime's Graves experiment, what have we discovered? We are only about halfway through our survey, and there's still a lot of work to be done on the results. But already it seems clear that although the flint mines were dug with primitive-looking tools, they were laid out according to a planned pattern with high safety standards and a high output of flint. I think we must conclude that mining was a professionally skilled activity and not just casual spare time work done by local farmers to fulfill their own limited need for flint. There is one major qualification to that. At the moment, our evidence suggests that each mine was closed down after about 6 months, so the miners could have worked at something else for the remaining half of the year. The effort put into mining at Grime's Graves and the output suggests there was a considerable demand for flint. Every aspect of the operation looks efficient, and the extraction rate of the flint is particularly impressive. The Neolithic peoples who produced these flint mines at Grime's Graves have left us the most substantial monument in Britain to the beginnings of the earliest industrial and commercial revolution.
Of a primate